Ladies and gentlemen, we are ready for our next panel three, character assassination in the U.S. presidential election, one of the most pressing and important topics to discuss. And I have the privilege of introducing our first presenter, my dear colleague, Bob Lichter from George Mason University, who has been exploring this topic of, you know, politics is a joke for many, many years, and he had a fantastic book just out last year, right? So his presentation with Steve Farnsworth is about late-night TV humor and the culture of ridicule.
Thank you, Sergei. Well, the advantage of studying political humor is you get to have fun talking about character assassination, which is difficult to do otherwise. But basically, what I'd like to do in this presentation is to provide a quick gloss on changes in the political and media systems over the last three decades, which have spurred concomitant changes in late-night talk shows and their increasing reliance on political humor. And basically, the argument is that late-night talk shows have become forums for political discourse as a result of other trends in American politics. Some of these are well known to all of us, that there is increased polarization at the elite and probably at the mass level as well. Politics has become more ideologically defined. Political discourse has broadened to include areas of private behavior and personal character that once were considered out of bounds. And these changes were communicated by a news media that itself was changing in its competitions, its norms, its attention to behavior that was previously considered off limits. And these changes have contributed to a long-term decline among the public in respect for both journalists and politicians. And what this has done is to normalize personal ridicule as a tool of political debate, of public spectacle, and of discrediting opponents, so that now, as we certainly witnessed in the past presidential campaign, accusations of personal characteristics such as personal handicaps, physical traits, lack of dexterity, unstylish dress and grooming actually are staples of the campaign trail to accuse your opponent of something that simply would not have been heard of 30 years ago. Meanwhile, the parties continue to fund opposition research, which flows into this stream and really ensures that it's going to continue in the foreseeable future. Now, that's a big picture. But actually, I would say that the changes in the American political system can be pretty well dated back to the late 1980s and are associated particularly with three names: Gary Hart, Robert Bork, and Dan Quayle. It's a strange trio to put together for you Americans, but we know now that John Kennedy had a very active sex life. Indeed, between revelations about how many physical ailments he had and how many mistresses he had, it's amazing he stayed out of bed long enough to run the country. But nobody knew that at the time. It wasn't news. Journalists didn't cover sexual indiscretions. They didn't cover drunkenness that often spilled over into the Congress. There was a private life that wasn't considered newsworthy. That began to change. The moment it really changed was in 1987, when Gary Hart, leading contender for the nomination of the Democratic Party for the presidency, was staked out by a news crew who showed him going into a townhouse with an attractive young woman. He was married to someone else, not coming out until the next day. And suddenly, the kind of thing that we've become familiar with since, but not then, occurred. You had what Larry Sabato termed a feeding frenzy of journalists, a scrum of journalists that followed Hart around and made it impossible for him to talk about anything other than his sex life. He had the bad luck to have had a photo taken of this young woman sitting on his lap on a yacht that was named the Monkey Business. Which, for those of you not from the United States, is a term that refers to the sort of thing that the two were probably doing. So that was bad publicity, showed up in the National Enquirer, and then on the CBS Evening News. And I remember thinking, this was in the National Enquirer, it can't be on CBS Evening News. Well, rules were changing very rapidly. Hart dropped out very quickly, and suddenly it was open season on politicians who had had affairs. Sabato, in a book I was privileged to co-author with him, did a follow-up book to his Feeding Frenzy, going through all of the different sex scandals that had occurred, and found many of them that referred to things that had happened decades earlier, had been put away by the participants, and basically served to titillate the public. So, new areas of life opened up. Judge Robert Bork, same year, 1987, nominated by Ronald Reagan as a conservative, a philosophical conservative, the Supreme Court, who really, because of his previous decisions as a lower court judge, scared liberal activist groups to the degree that they basically decided to run a political campaign against him. Paid attack ads, speeches on the Senate. Ted Kennedy accused him of leading us back to an age of back alley abortions, segregated lunch counters, and rogue police attacks. Bork lost by the largest margin a nominee has ever been defeated for the nomination by, and he did have the satisfaction of seeing a new verb coined. The verb bork, to bork is defined in the Oxford English Dictionary, is to obstruct someone by systematically defaming or vilifying them. And this then brought a new spirit to nominations on both sides of the aisle, which we're happily seeing the results of again, as we speak. Finally, on a somewhat lower level of seriousness, Dan Quayle, was a surprise nominee for vice president by President George H.W. Bush. He very quickly established a reputation with journalists as a lightweight who really didn't know how to answer questions, couldn't handle the bright lights or the heat, and they began to treat him as a kind of figure of fun, a court jester, which was cemented by his remarkable inability to spell the word potato. In a forum in which he tried to correct an elementary school student by saying you have to add E to the end of potato. And he immediately, every story about Dan Quayle was Mr. Potato Head and so on and so forth. So as if this wasn't enough, the next president of the United States was, of course, Bill Clinton, who arrived trailing allegations of scandal behind him, which never left, led up eventually to the famous liaison with intern Monica Lewinsky in 1998, an effort by Republicans to impeach him, which backfired because journalists sensed hypocrisy and started looking at Republican sex lives. Larry Flint, the publisher of pornographic magazine Hustler, put out $1 million bounty on stories of Republicans who had affairs, which knocked off the incoming Speaker of the House, Bob Livingston. We're living in a different world now in politics from the one that existed not too long before. Meanwhile, approval ratings of both politicians and journalists are dropping precipitously and continue to do so through this day. Well, as there's more to laugh at in the world of politics, the political humorists begin to find more jokes to make. Really, until the 1990s, entertainment media stayed clear of politics for the most part, relying on the adage, satire is what closes on Saturday night. It just wasn't worth it. Well, in fact, I have to say, as an exception, satire is what you could see on Saturday night live on NBC starting in the mid-1970s, when in a foreshadowing of what was to come, after President Gerald Ford was caught on tape, stumbling and looking foolish, dropping down after trying to get out of Air Force One and not being able to do so. Comedian Chevy Chase, a cast member of SNL, began opening up every show, turning Bush's fall into a pratfall, knocking over the Oval Office desk, knocking down a Christmas tree, and he would end this with, and now, New York, live from New York, Saturday night. And the irony here is that Gerald Ford is regarded now as a bumbling oaf. Physically, he was in fact an All-American football player at University of Michigan, which twice during his tenure won national championships. but that Gerald Ford can't compete with Chevy Chase's Gerald Ford. By the way, I have time for a brief aside here. They became friends later, Chevy Chase and President Ford, who had a good sense of humor. And indeed, when Chevy Chase had to dry out after the kinds of problems that celebrities often have, he went to the Betty Ford Clinic in order to do so. So it all worked out. However, beyond Saturday Night Live, in which you had weekly and only sporadic political material, all the sketch humor done, you didn't see a lot of humor in late-night talk shows. The king of late-night then was Johnny Carson, who didn't do a lot of political material. This started to change when Jay Leno took over Carson's slot in 1992. David Letterman came in a year later, and they both began to use much more political material. So we know the next major change came in the 1990s when Jon Stewart brought genuine satire into late-night humor on The Daily Show, and was, in return, was treated in national surveys as one of the most highly respected American journalists, even though he always identified himself as a purveyor of what we then thought of benignly as fake news, quote unquote. So what happens now is you start to get a lot of political jokes on late night talk shows. Center for Media and Public Affairs, which I had, you know, there we go. I skipped this. I hate PowerPoint. You start to get more jokes. We go from 3,000 jokes to 7,000 jokes in a period of five different election years. And we find that these jokes, the more powerful the politician, the more jokes you get. 17 out of the 21 years in the study, which included over 100,000 jokes. The number one target was the President of the United States. The only exceptions were when losing presidential candidates, Bob Dole, Dole, Romney, and McCain edged out the incumbents. And in 2001, Bill Clinton was still such a beloved figure by comedians that he actually had more jokes about him in 2001 as the outgoing president than George W. Bush did as the incoming president. But for the most part, if you're a president, you can expect to get a lot of humor your way. And these humors, the humor tends to be about personal characteristics. So there's simple stereotyping that goes on. Really started with Dan Quayle. Had jokes of the type, Quayle was asked, how do we solve global warming? And he said, central air conditioning. So, bada boom, it's a Jay Leno joke. Okay, not my fault, folks, I don't know the material, I just deliver it. George W. Bush, who holds degrees from Yale and Harvard, produced 40% of his jokes, over 2,000 jokes, about his intelligence, including his jumbled speaking style. I've had people swear to me that they heard George W. Bush use the term strategery for strategy, which was actually coined by his impersonator, Will Ferrell. Let's see, what do we have with Bush? When Bush was revealed to have had a DUI violation, Conan O'Brien remarked, the arresting officer became suspicious when he noticed George W. wasn't slurring his words. So this goes on and on to the point when Bush was president-elect, David Letterman started a joke saying, the White House is giving intelligent briefings to Bush. And he paused and said, you know, these jokes just write themselves sometimes. So Barack Obama was a partial exception to this. We have Obama there. The number of jokes came down. Even many of the Obama jokes tended to be jokes about how he was lionized by his followers. Jon Stewart, when Obama took a trip to Israel, Stewart said they took a side trip to visit the manger in Bethlehem where he was born. But these jokes continued night after night, thousand after thousand, and eventually they end up with Donald Trump. Let's see, I got target individuals, charterly presidential candidates. Here we go. There we go, and we see a number of jokes about presidential candidates. Donald Trump, vastly in advance of anybody else, over three times the number of jokes about Hillary Clinton. I'm too depressed to repeat any Trump jokes. They're easily found online or every night. When Jimmy Fallon did an interview with Trump and playfully tousled his hair, he was criticized for not being critical enough of Trump. In other words, late-night talk shows are being treated like journalists now. It's their job to go after these candidates, when in fact the candidates go onto these shows as their only defense against the jokes by going on to show that they can be a good sport. So that's basically where things stand. Well, where they really stand right now is that, to update this, since he took office, first 5 weeks of the Trump administration on Kimmel, Fallon, Colbert, and Trevor Noah, The Daily Show, 5 weeks, 472 Trump jokes, not mentioning jokes about his family, his administration appointees, and so on and so forth. We're looking at 5,000 Trump jokes a year, which means that political humor, partly because these jokes are bouncing around the internet, they're picked up by journalists who use them as an opportunity to illustrate the points they're making about the weaknesses of these candidates. We're living in a world where there's really great fluidity between news and entertainment in political discourse. So basically, over the last 30 years, there have been major changes in political discourse that have come to include political humor, which is fun, but also feeds into a growing culture in which it's increasingly acceptable to ridicule candidates and presidents. Today, the journalists knock the politicians off their stride, and then the humorists kick them while they're down. Now, in the narrow sense, of course, Trump is right to call journalists the opposition party. Of course, when you declare war on them, you tend to expect that kind of thing. But, you know, mainstream journalists typically come into conflict with presidents because their professional norms dictate that they strip the propaganda out of politicians' messages. But in this endless battle between the media and the politicians, late-night humor has opened up a second front. Now, I seem to be arguing that this is a bad thing, and I believe in some ways it is a bad thing in the big picture. I would feel that I had lost something very important in my life if these shows all disappeared immediately. I'm well aware that laughing at political leaders can be a healthy expression of public skepticism, and particularly in authoritarian societies, a safety valve for public disaffection. And there's no doubt that the failings and antics of the political class deserve a good horse laugh now and again. After all, character assassination assumes there is some character to be assassinated. So there is that argument. But nonetheless, for all these good reasons to enjoy political humor, I think we have to also accept that in an era of heightened negativity of political discourse, the advent of political humor as a major factor is feeding into a loss in public respect for the political system. And without sounding partisan, we've seen what that can do in a presidential election. Actually, we also found that if we looked using our data set going back to 1992, to a statistically significant degree, presidential candidates who were joked about tended to fare more poorly in favorability ratings in polls. In other words, there was a positive statistically significant relationship between favorability ratings and number of jokes which preceded them. So, Will Rogers once said, where's Will Rogers here? Notice I don't do well with PowerPoint. I'm a pre-PowerPoint person, never fully adapted. Okay, Will Rogers once said that today everything is changing. People are taking their comedians seriously and their politicians as a joke. And there may be something good in that, but I think we also have to consider a prescient comment by Neil Postman talking about television, of all things, 30 years ago, just when the changes were about to occur, when he worried that we might be amusing ourselves to death. Thank you.
We're going to take questions afterward, so we have to make sure that everybody had a chance to present. So the next presentation is by Michael Kornfield from George Washington University. Crooked Hillary and Locked Her Up, How an Extreme Campaign Attack Lived on Twitter.
Leaving us find it. Okay. I'm not sure I know how to make this larger. I think I did. Nope. All right, you want to help me with this? All right.
Yeah, bring it back up.
All right, we'll just leave it at that. My name's Michael Kornfield. I teach in the department. I teach. What?
Thanks. I like to walk. Phil Donahue, exactly right. We're old enough to remember him. So I teach at a school for campaigning, the nuts and bolts of how to campaign. So my perspective is a little bit different, but I am going to talk about rhetoric. And in particular, I'm going to talk about rhetoric on Twitter. And for me, what's transformative about Twitter and other social media is not just that it gives lots of people voices that can be heard in real time, but that we can study their voices, which means after centuries of millennia, really, of studying speeches and debates, we can study with great particularity the reactions of people to speeches and debates. So for me, it's not just about Trump's tweets. It's about how many people are retweeting him and what they are saying. So that's where we're going with this presentation. Character assassination by crowd. I use a system, a social media monitoring and archiving system called Crimson Hexagon. And what you do, they have archived every single tweet since 2008. And what you do is you enter search terms, you enter a period of time, and then you look at what you get back. And so I'm going to show you a little bit about what we found so far in the tweeting about the 2016 presidential debate. These are the top hashtag phrases. Those are the number of times those hashtags appeared on Twitter between January 1st, 2016, and the election day, November 8. And I know this is a conference about negativity. It's a character assassination conference. And I know a lot of people are going to talk to you about negative advertising and negative jokes. The number one message on Twitter is so-called negative place, and it isn't even close, was a positive message. You may not agree with that message, but that message gave people hope. That was the number one message. Make America great again. I put in Black Lives Matter just so you can see it as a sort of a benchmark. Black Lives Matter is a political movement that has lived on social media in large part. And then we get to Hillary Clinton's positive message, I'm with her. Again, positive messages more frequent than negative messages. Then comes Never Trump, which was the anti-Trump movement born in the Republican Party out of desperation when they realized, some of them, that they weren't going to stop him. And then comes our first really negative message, Crooked Hillary, at about 5.8 million. Hillary's second message, positive message, Stronger Together, basket of deplorables, a thing that I'm sure she will go to her grave regretting that she ever said. Lock her up, which is going to be the most interesting one, build the wall, and delete your account. Now, in political campaigning, what we do with our messages is we plot them on what's called a message grid. It's a 2x2 table. What I say about myself, what my opponent says about myself, what I say about my opponent, and what my opponent says about me. It's an organizing template to plan strategy for communications.
Oops. For some reason it's not coming in. All right.
Suffice it to say that Hillary Clinton, who had a very negative message about Donald Trump, that he was temperamentally unfit, never used that as a hashtag. One of many, many strategic errors and tactical blunders by the Hillary Clinton campaign. From our standpoint, the worst presidential campaign, general campaign, probably in a generation. He didn't win this, she lost this. Donald Trump trademarked Make America Great Again 2 weeks after the 2012 election. He had started on Twitter in 2011. So he's not just a master of the technique, he had a bigger following on the day he declared his candidacy. I look at all the announcement speeches in my work, and I would be remiss not to note that one of the candidates for president in 2016 declared his candidacy in this building. Does anybody know who? His name was Lincoln Chafee. He's a senator from Rhode Island. And I swear I'm not making this up. His campaign platform was to put the United States on the metric system, which is why none of you have heard of him. But he declared his candidacy, even though he's from Rhode Island, he declared his candidacy in Founders Hall. So there you go. You're sitting in a historical location. Now, there is a chart that shows you the number of times hashtag Crooked Hillary was tweeted every day in 2016. Trump came up with it, as you can see, in mid-April. And it went up, it went way up in July. Times of the conventions, it went way up again in October when the FBI director decided to participate in our electoral process. And I regard Crooked Hillary not as character assassination, but as standard political discourse in the United States. I don't see that as particularly malicious. And I certainly don't see it as any more malicious than unfit to be president, temperamentally unfit, which was very present in her advertisements, but strangely, again, not on Twitter. And while I would agree with my old friend Bob that negative messaging was large and ridicule was largely absent from mainstream media from roughly after the Second World War until Chappaquiddick, Watergate, Gary Hart and Bob Bork, I hope he would agree with me that if you take the longer view, the 19th century was full of character assassination. And if you don't believe me, go get the soundtrack to Hamilton and play the song The Election of 1800. You will see accusations and truthful accusations about sexual misconduct, financial misconduct, treason, and that's just 1800. And it goes pretty much through the entire 19th century. So I see the period you started with as the exception in the entire history of the United States. I agree with you that in those years we didn't have this. But I guess what I see today is a restoration, not an innovation. The innovation comes when we look at the use of Twitter and other social media. Now, this is Lock Her Up. Lock Her Up doesn't even appear until July 16th, the first night of the Republican convention in Cleveland, Ohio. And on that night, and I was there, a man named Michael Flynn, you might remember him, gave a speech, and during his speech, the crowd began to chant, "Lock her up, lock her up." The phrase, I'm giving an asterisk here, the phrase originated not with the speaker, but with the audience. I'm going to tell you who in a minute. And you're going to be very surprised, because I was. Somebody had to start it as right. I should point out that before Lock Her Up, there were a lot of references to the concept of putting Hillary in prison. If you walk down the streets in Cleveland or at any of the Trump rallies, you would see people selling her pantsuit turned into an orange prison jumpsuit, Hillary for prison, all of that, right? I'm just talking about this rhythmic, euphonic, three-word USA, USA, lock her up, lock her up. And what's different about this phrase, in addition to the fact that it appeared to originate with the audience, and certainly the audience and the social media audience sustained it, is that this is a punishment. And that's relatively new. People went after John Kerry for Swift boating. People went after John McCain for fathering children out of wedlock, for having affairs, for having children of all sorts of things. People went after Michael Dukakis for letting Willie Horton out of jail. But in none of those instances, which is in the post-television insult period that Bob documented, did we have the additional assassination of, and therefore put her in jail. The punishment part is the new part. Okay? That's the sort of thing that we associate not with democracies, but with authoritarian societies in Latin America, in Africa, and in Russia. The phrase "lock her up" originated with respect to this woman. Anybody recognize her? Who is she? And who? And where is she from? Ukraine. In 2010, and I'm sorry, I can't. Yulia Tymoshenko ran against Viktor Yanukovych for president, and it was in that campaign that we have the first documented instances of crowds yelling, and this is at rallies, "Lock her up, lock her up." They did. They locked her up for 3 years. The campaign manager for the man who ran Viktor Yanukovych's campaign is the same man who was running Donald Trump's campaign, Paul Manafort. I can't connect the dots yet. I'm working real hard on this. So it's just a circumstantial supposition at this point. I'm working on it. But I don't think that chant started spontaneously. Nevertheless, even if my lurid interpretation is true, the fact remains that whoever started it, people sustained it. It became popular. It became a meme. So I guess the lesson of this is that we are in a time now where character assassination does not necessarily depend on the speaker or the campaign to have an impact. That there can be a cumulative process of character assassination in the context of a political campaign that can make a difference. Thank you.
Right, our next presenter is Colleen Kelley, Digital Character Assassination Campaign 2016, Unprecedented Strategies and Precedent-Setting Campaign.
Set my little timer so that I can honor my, sort of honor our time commitment. Give me a second here. I think I can do this. Okay. Let me begin by prefacing very quickly a little bit about my background. I am an academician and better? Can you hear me now? Yes? All right. I'll try to stay close here. By vocation and training, for the last well over 25 years, I have taught at a university, and I have a PhD in rhetoric, classical ancient study of persuasion. My research focus, though, has been on the American presidency, particularly focused on rhetorical strategies involving the impeachment of Bill Clinton, and then the decision of the most recent Mr. Bush to move into the Middle East. And I do want to make the point that Aristotelian rhetoric and democracy both came into existence at the same time in a codependent kind of relationship. And I make the argument that that codependency still informs our 21st century, certainly American political campaign. I'd like to start by noting that the 2016 campaign, I believe, was unprecedented for many reasons, not the least of which was that one of the candidates, Mrs. Clinton, had been identified as one of the most, if not the most qualified candidates for president in our history. And one of the other, Mr. Trump, was identified as the least qualified. Now, I realize that can be argued, but that's a premise that I'm working with here. My original research track, and it still is my main focus, I came here by a luck of having Sergei, I guess, come in and speak to my national meeting in November, and it got my attention. But I'm spending most of my research focus on this campaign track, studying how Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump positioned themselves as outsiders whose strategies coalesced, intentionally or not, into a joint campaign against Clinton. And after losing, Sanders endorsed Clinton, albeit reluctantly and late in the game. The pivot point here, and this is where my research really focuses now, is that Trump essentially fine-tuned what I consider his slash and burn, and I call it digitally driven strategies, with which he took the Republican nomination and, as we all know, turned it into a mediated juggernaut, which ultimately gave him the American presidency. I argue that, contrary to at least some of the perspectives that I think are intuited in the practical focus that is certainly a theme of this conference, you look at the big picture, language is not merely a tool for describing objective reality, but it's the creator of our social world of experience. This premise indeed undergirds the works of one of my primary theorists that has informed my work for 30 years, and that is Kenneth Burke, who considers symbolic action, or the use of language in speech, and symbolic action other than language as well, but primarily speech, as the primary means with which humans influence each other. Identification is the key term, and it's an extension of the traditional term persuasion. So what I go on from there is that by sharing values and beliefs, we find that humans do build identification, and another Burkean term that is substantial here is the word consubstantial, which is his term for what happens when you use your identification to bridge with other people so that you end up sharing their truths with them. Sharing with leaders, to pivot to this train of research for this afternoon, is a potent form of identification. I argue that Trump's digitally mediated assault against Clinton persuaded his audience, his target audience, to identify with Trump as he rhetorically argued that these disenfranchised voters would be vindicated and therefore saved by him if they indeed supported him in his election. So from Ted Cruz's first announcement in 2015 through November of last year, 128 Americans on Facebook generated over 8 billion interactions. Now that's interactions, that's including retweets as well. 1 billion tweets were related to the presidential campaign and were sent out between August and November. Mr. Trump earned 142 million interactions on Facebook, 70 million tweets, more than double that of Mrs. Clinton. So rather than trying to broadly appeal to the mainstream or a middle-of-the-road constituency, Mr. Trump targeted a personal message to what he considered to be only the right audience, and that was the focus group that he worked with. What he did was to discursively create Mrs. Clinton as a dysfunctional and abusive mainstream political animal. His strategies included, and we've had several of them mentioned already, and I think they'll be mentioned again throughout this conference, his discursive strategies included apocalyptic and misogynistic framing, the use of vague and loaded terms, pandering, scapegoating, and demonizing, not all of which certainly fall under the rubric of character assassination, at least as I understand it. I'm new to the concepts, so bear with me here as I kind of try to mash these areas together. FYI, it's also anecdotally noteworthy that Mr. Trump's use of grammar is at the level of a fifth grader. Now, less sophisticated language in American politics is certainly nothing new. It's not unusual at all. However, it has been argued that Mr. Trump's may stand out in that he seems to intuit, and this is someone else's quote, that many of his supporters are not grammarians. Unintentional or not, and this is meant to be a serious takeaway that I won't spend much more time on, speaking like an 11-year-old may indeed have been a way for Mr. Trump to even maybe tacitly identify with at least a portion of his constituency. 32 million American adults can't read at all, and fully 21% of American adults read below the level of the fifth grade. Now that's just anecdotal. I'm not sure it plays into the actual research, but I thought that was an excellent example of how identification might work, albeit in a tacit kind of way. Now, to go quick here. One of the most compelling and time-constant truths that began evolving during the rise of my discipline, classical rhetorical theory, 25 centuries ago, was indeed, and I'm going to say this twice, words matter. Words do matter. Regardless of how humans produce and consume them, this is relevant certainly when considering digital media and the attacks which at least from my perspective, are actually more about words and strategy than media technology and delivery system, although I know those are factored in. I'm looking at the internet and social digitalized media primarily as a channel through which words and symbolic interaction can be carried to merge or identify in this Burkean concept. And the internet is phenomenal, as we all have talked about in here, and many of you know much more than I do. It's instantaneity, it's 24/7 global reach, eternal memory, deep search capability, instant retrieval. Still, as with the paper world from the American Revolution, when so much of this was also occurring, albeit in different form, the digital world of the 21st century does have its Facebook prostitutes, and it also has digital exposés to kind of give an homage to Hamilton here. This historical context does provide the rationale for a template that I have on the screen behind me. Researchers Torrenzano and Davis have identified what they call swords or strategies for character assassination digitally that are used in the internet age, and I argue that they are all utilized in Mr. Trump's discourse. I don't want to take a great deal of my time to go through each one of them. I have it in my paper extensively identified with examples of some suggested tweets and social media use that have come out as illustrative of these kinds of techniques. I'll just give you a couple. In terms of sword number three, the strategy of using an evil clone, the researchers argue that this strategy slams a personal reputation by stealing an identity to make it appear as if one has done something stupid, wrong, or terrible. Even the exonerated, according to these researchers, pay a reputational price, as did Clinton, in my view. After being cleared of wrongdoing by the FBI, she was declared guilty by public opinion and reputationally scarred, so that anyone looking at her in the aftermath could only see where the original cut was made. Very quickly, I wanted to mention one more. Jihad by proxy is another one of these swords. When campaigns are launched against an individual, in this case, Mrs. Clinton, through a front organization, often an automated army, for example, of almost entirely anonymous pro-Trump chat bots. It's not my quote. Yelling fools. I love that. That was another quote describing these chat box. They so overwhelmed Mrs. Clinton that her similar strategies were outgunned 5-1. So, and again, the others all have follow-ups and significant points of illustration to support their notion that there was clearly a digital kind of character assassination that could be argued did occur. As has also been mentioned here, rhetoricians have grappled with attack speech, not known as character assassination, since the Aristotelian era. The danger was that such a leader, elevated by a democracy or an open free society, would have no official executive position, but could still determine policy if they were lifted by official acclamation or protocol within the society. So then and now we have a mirrored situation, according to some, with Mr. Trump, who can argue that he can't be held accountable because he wasn't there, or the one who, for example, when he retweets a message, who created the original post, but was simply giving voice to an idea, so he is able to distance himself from the original message. I would argue that then, meaning in the Aristotelian era, and now, our 21st century high-tech digitalized information world, the defining feature of, and I'm going to use the word demagogues, was their refusal to accept and take responsibility for the messages that they perform. Now, 18th century Americans, including John Adams, who warned, and I quote, that a democracy never lasts long. It soon wastes, exhausts, and murders itself. were fearful of demagogues, and this is back when we were just starting in our system, whose inflammatory rhetoric stirred, quote, the very passions of the founders who envisioned their democracy. According to some, this may be a fairly apt, if not spot-on accurate description of what may be going on right now with the situation with Donald Trump. Americans have spent 2 decades, as we heard a moment ago, hearing that the government is criminal, that democratic leaders betray their country or spend it into bankruptcy, that national health care is a tyranny to resist, and most recently, that Hillary Clinton was the incarnation of all these, or at least had something to do with all of them. As such, it is not perhaps surprising that many of these same Americans were eager to follow a man who tells them to punch whomever they don't like in the face. And I'm not necessarily being flippant when I say that. It can reasonably be argued that a perfect storm of elements did coalesce beyond those related to this character assassination study that I'm suggesting here. We do know, for example, that there were so many elements that may have overwhelmed Clinton by November 8th, such as the innuendo-driven rhetorical campaign by the FBI or by Russia's Trump-enabling cyber attacks. Regardless of what you think about the origins, those all coalesced together to weaken her so that she may not have had a chance winning the campaign anyway. I do argue, though, that Clinton's defeat was inevitable, in large part because Trump successfully imagined, and I'll just use my words here, executed a malignant facade, ethos, a word we just heard earlier this afternoon, for the Democratic candidate created through digital and socially mediated character assassination. By dividing the country against itself, Mr. Trump created a cognitive space within which those disenfranchised members of the electorate could identify with him and divide against her. So for those of us who do understand this but don't agree with his use of this strategy, this can be problematic and indeed can be troublesome. How a society elects a leader communicates, how a freely elected leader in a society communicates, particularly if she or he disappears into a populist and nationalistic linguistic universe, is significant, I argue, partly because of my discipline's frame, since such a system is not called into existence until a leader is raised to power by a compliant social or democratic system. One does not have to be, and I'm going to use the word, a fascist to utilize communication that primes a democracy, and again, this is not my quote, for rabble when a rabble-rouser has found them. In other words, there are people who are opportunistic and intentionally, usually, but not always possibly, take advantage of these systems. Since the American presidency is rhetorical, the office assures its CEO, the president, and their surrogates of powerful, powerful credibility. And media guarantees instantaneous delivery. We've heard that many times now during this conference. So what we see is that the credibility and of the media guarantees this instant delivery, and there's a default public discourse that arises. I argue that's grounded in corporate statism, strong-arming, and pandering hegemony, and I believe, and as a rhetorical critic, I make this statement, this is serious business. So, in conclusion, what my essay actually is to offer a standpoint, a departure for conversation, perhaps, to assess communication ground responsibilities, and I use that word intentionally, of an interaction between the presidency and the presidency's citizens, and how these obligations, how these behaviors nurture an effective and healthy post-campaign participatory democracy. Ultimately, by word and deed, if not by official proclamation, I believe that Mr. Trump is close to enacting policy guided not by statesmanship, but rather electronically mediated appeals where he has unified people mindfully or not to become consubstantial with him. And so reconfigure the democracy into something that may ultimately become other than a democracy. So in conclusion, very quickly, 25 centuries of rhetorical theory. I'm very humbled by it and proud to be a very small part of it, as well as Mr. Trump's own pugnacious rhetoric, prove that his words do matter. He powerfully and successfully presented a rhetoric of otherness to his target base, for whom he created, reinforced, and embellished perceptions of abandonment, of anger, and resentment, and for whom he created, ultimately, a unification with him. So that this digitally driven rhetorical mechanism was so successful in creating and perpetuating an angry orphan persona for his marginalized electorate that this outsider with a 30-year history of extreme wealth, investments, and political party opportunism became America's first commander in tweet and the 45th president of the United States. Thank you.
On this optimistic note, we have Allan Louden and Ryan Wolfe from Wake Forest University, all the way from North Carolina, coming here, and so they're going to talk about American democracy's character in presidential attack advertising. So two of you will present, right? So you might have. All right. Yeah. So it could be stand up.
This is the. That one's dead. This is the one that works.
So I'm giving you that. I should use the one that works.
At least you know how to.
Maybe. Yeah, we wanted to lifestyle a little bit. We got a little video. This was fun. Burke's God. I get that. I don't know if I agree with your conclusions, but I get Burke is God. I worship that. I love those old stories because I remember them all in real terms, and it was really fun. And I hadn't heard anybody make the claim that these elections now, which are got a little rascally, really are just a reincarnation of how it used to be, and now we're back to normal after we got rid of just three networks telling us all what to think, right? So it's kind of interesting. I have to hear somebody else have that point of view. We're doing political ads. Everything so far has said they don't count. It's all social media, except the political ads are on social media, and they're happening. I collect ads. I have over 2,000 ads from this cycle. So if they don't matter, I don't know who's spending all that money. I know Hillary's spending a lot more money on ads than Trump was, but they are also spending quite a bit, and all the surrogate groups. This, I'm a rhetorician, but we're going to do numbers today. We're actually going to be quantitative. We looked at the character in presidential attack advertising. Our sample, 491 ads that have the form of ads, some of which were only on social media, but 491 ads that talk about character in the negative attack mode. That's a lot. And not all is in this cycle of the race. It's kind of fun to put up there the Daisy because these aren't, you know, negative ad isn't new, as we all know. Daisy spot. Ignore the other for a minute there because that's counting things that shouldn't have been counted here and I didn't have time to change it. Except that I did think when I was looking at that, there were three ads with psychoanalysts indicating why Trump was should be put away by official psychoanalysts given the panel earlier. That was interesting. This is what the ads were about. Race, women, business ties, which is really scandal and you can't run a business, foreign policy, which is really scandal about Libya, scandals, straight up ads, we're talking 85 ads that just are about scandal. They're not about any particular topic, scandal after scandal, we'll look at that, and also ads that were just strings of quotations by the opponent. Indict them with themselves. And so all kinds of things are going on here.
Okay, so one thing that we looked at was ad length. So really kind of the two largest kinds of lengths we had were 30-second spots and 60-second spots. Now the reason why they were both the largest was because they can play both online and on TV, and they're easy to watch. Also, there was kind of an abnormal amount of long-form advertisements about character in this election. That 1.5 to 4 minute segment was usually YouTube videos meant to be shared on social media rather than to be viewed on television or listened to on radio. So these kind of long form attacks were something kind of unique to this race and unique to the kind of role of media, of social media in this election cycle.
We also looked at where they were coming from, thinking that the candidates' ads would be different from the institutional ads, which would be different from the crazy groups, ideological groups, etc. And Ryan?
Yeah, so what we found was is that candidates and ideological groups tend to run the harshest advertisements. Now, when we have conventional advertisements and blatant advertisements, we kind of characterize that by making a distinction based on the kind of words that we use in ads. Blatant advertisements usually had attacks that characterized one candidate. The main two was that Trump is unfit, Hillary Clinton is a liar. Very loaded words, loaded language. Conventional advertisements tended to take a form that used a lot of internal documentation that were usually more focused on issues, but made a character judgment at the end of the day. And so what we found was is that candidates and ideological groups actually were more harsh than political party groups, candidate associated groups, or institutional groups. So basically the candidates were actually just as bad as what you would expect the attack dog ideological super PACs to be in this cycle.
We used four categories, going back to the social psych, kinder, and cognitive folks, on leadership, which was basically about judgment or moral leadership. You know, are you going to make bad decisions, and are you a good person in terms of leading the country in the right direction? Competence, which is always, you know, are you an insider, or are you have stability, are you have ability? Integrity, honesty, self-serving, hypocrisy. And empathy, not caring for others, not expecting a lot of that, because you don't usually have that in these races. See the number of ads. There were 162 ads. That was about empathy, whether the person cared about people or not, which we took as more in line with the integrity notion, because these are personal, person-based judgments, unlike the other, which might be a policy or you don't know what you're doing kind of thing. So that was you see the numbers there on the ads. These categories we thought might be too simple in a sense that wouldn't capture, but boy, they really did capture what was going on. You could place them in there without much trouble.
So one other thing that we looked at is when these more blatant character attack ads ran during the campaign. More or less what we found was that in July and October and November, blatant ads were the most frequent. And so that was in line with the conventions. Obviously, a lot of ads get aired then, more or less to try to make the message of whatever party's convention is going on less effective. And then October and November to close out the race.
You know, we understand that you can't see all those numbers, but once you want to capture the, if you want the PowerPoint, you can actually see the numbers because they're really quite interesting. But I guess for a rhetorician to show I had numbers was so important to me. I hope that makes sense. Ads. We like to show some ads.
Lies, cover-ups, and scandal have finally caught up with Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton is under FBI investigation again after her emails were found on pervert Anthony Weiner's laptop. Think about that. America's most sensitive secrets unlawfully sent, received, and exposed by Hillary Clinton, her staff, and Anthony Weiner. Hillary cannot lead a nation while crippled by a criminal investigation. Hillary Clinton, unfit to serve.
I'm Donald Trump, and I approve this message.
That's actually a candidate ad. And you can say these kind of things. This is late in the race. Talk about this being a race about candidate assassination, because it's about real character in the sense. The integrity dominated Well, we're going to come back to the integrity big thing. A couple more examples, because these are ones you probably see. We were in a toss-up state, so we've got to see all the ads, right?
I love the old days. You know what they used to do to guys like that when they were in a place like this? They'd be carried out on a stretcher, folks. And you can tell them to go themselves.
I could stand in the middle of Fifth Avenue and shoot somebody, and I wouldn't lose any voters, okay? It's like incredible.
When Mexico sends its people, they're bringing drugs, they're bringing crime, they're rapists.
You know, you could see there was blood coming out of her eyes, blood coming out of her wherever.
You gotta see this guy, oh, I don't know what I said, oh, I don't remember. He's going like, I don't remember.
Our children.
That's about him testifying itself. It is about, I can't remember ads in the old days that used the word F word and other kind of things in there. And the language in these ads is qualitatively different in other past races. I don't have data on that yet. We're getting back to the number two one there. Looks like you want slide 7. Yep.
About this one again.
Have you ever won a drinking competition?
We were on a congressional delegation drinking vodka until we both, I think, agreed to withdraw.
I did not email any classified material to anyone on my email. There is no classified material.
110 emails in 52 email chains have been determined by the owning agency to contain classified information at the time they were sent or received.
We've seen rage and violence directed at American embassies over an awful internet video that we had nothing to do with.
The next day, within 24 hours, you had a conversation with the Egyptian Prime Minister. You told him this: we know, not we think, not it might be, we know the attack in Libya had nothing to do with the film. It was a planned attack, not a protest. State Department experts knew the truth. You knew the truth. That's not what the American people got.
And this, the significance was really high. That basically, while there were integrity ads ran against both of them, almost all the ads ran against Hillary were about lying and truthfulness and integrity. There's a lot of research that indicates that honesty and trustworthiness is much more probative than, say, competence or something like that, or even assumed leadership. While they're important, almost everything against her was about integrity, and there was a thematic way in which it just all held together, and we got the numbers to show it. And the stuff about him was different, including Hillary's stuff. There were certainly integrity things, the business stuff, but it was basically about competence. He can't do, he's unfit, leadership, he's stupid and doesn't make good decisions, he likes Putin, and empathy. That's my black person. Remember that one? Or my, I don't know how you said it exactly, but all those kind of ads, you know, that talked about empathy kind of things. And especially, a lot of times they were institutional ads, and they were narratives too, also in the sense like union stories or immigrants who were going to be deported, that kind of thing. Really powerful stuff. And the numbers there will also verify the fact that these are the kind of ads that were run against him. There's an argument to be had that integrity trumps competence and leadership, maybe. I'm a little more troubled on empathy, because that's pretty much a personal characteristic thing that we care about a lot too. I'm not sure how it trumps it, honestly.
I think I'm probably the most transparent person in public life. I feel you know a lot more about me than you know about anybody else. I think I'm probably the most transparent person in public life. Stay tuned, there'll be a lot more.
You know, you can see there was blood coming out of her eyes, blood coming out of her wherever.
Does she have a good body? No. Does she have a fat ass? Absolutely.
You like girls that are 5'1", they come up to you know where.
If Ivanka weren't my daughter, perhaps I'd be dating her.
I view a person who's flat-chested is very hard to be a 10.
And you can tell them to go.
You see, we had that category for content called quotes because this happens over and over and over again, just a laundry list of quotes. This is the one where the women are speaking, mouthing his words. There are other ones where the children are speaking, mouthing his words and all that kind of thing. We'll come back to that maybe at the end if we have time about how, in a sense, the Hillary ads end up putting Trump out front in kind of a leadership in your face way.
Sorry, this computer's.
Too reckless, too dangerous. The language is amazing. The opponent's self-indicting governs the ad formats. We tested several formats, including narrative and third party and people who were official and non-official. There's a lot of use of other people testifying. This was nuts to me. I think I can't remember what the number was. Let's see. It was something like 70% of the ads had the opponent speaking. That happens a lot in ads, but not 70%. Like everything was about. So I saw this cartoon early on in the race where there was a cartoon that said the storefronts in the street, right? And the cat was a big sign said, I'm not here, her, him. The other one said, I'm not her. So it's not surprising it was about the actual character of these folks. Self-indicting and people testifying against them, like Obama against Michelle, against Hillary, and other people testifying against Trump. And then the really powerful ones were non-public figures doing narrative testimonies. There was a lot of that. There's not many ads that didn't have some form of testimony, the old notion of straightforward issue spot that we're used to.
So yeah, so it was 65% of all ads have the opponent speaking. And so kind of what we saw here was that the main kind of message form was opponent speaking, and it also tended to be one of the most blatant forms. The kind of clearest, most blatant form came from the exaggerated audio visuals, which we have an example of coming up, as well as parody advertisements. So it's very interesting to kind of hear about the role of late night humor, and that is now kind of seeped into political advertising as kind of using satire to kind of sap the ethos out of your opponent. There's also a lot of written documentation, which tended to be more conventional, but usually these forms were used across all kinds, and you know, most of them are very close to 50-50 blatant and conventional forms. So really character assassinations were used through all kinds of forms.
Well, I noticed they documented with the written documentation. This is from the New York Times and stuff and all that kind of thing. That disappears late in the race. We haven't checked that number yet, but it tends to go away. They just throw it in there as a big headline. And just everybody's to assume it's true, which is interesting. Maybe they've already gotten by that. Okay.
The reason a lot of Klan members like Donald Trump is because a lot of what he believes, we believe in. Donald Trump would be best for the job.
For president.
Yeah.
I am a farmer and white nationalist. Support Donald Trump.
Sending out all the elite.
Last two real quick there. Yeah, conventional ads and blatant. Clinton ads were more harsh, surprisingly. Even though we're harsh against her, but her ads also, the ads against her were more harsh in all the ways we were talking about it, and they were also more focused.
Right. The this is potentially because of just the nature of how the Trump campaign and Trump-affiliated groups did advertisements. Trump-affiliated groups and institutional groups supporting Trump did not produce that many ads. And so when they did, they went after Clinton hard, which is why 52% of their ads that attacked her character were blatant attacks. Now, Clinton's campaign and her affiliated groups produced a ton more ads than he did. So, just raw count numbers, she had more blatant character attack ads than Trump did based on raw count. But because she produced so many ads, she attacked his character from basically every angle, which is why, you know, she had about 120 more conventional character attack ads than he did as well.
That's the thing. Well, and the outside use of language. We collected the big things that flash up there in big print, or the kicker at the end of the ad, which tells you how to understand it. And this is a word cloud that resulted. President Hillary, America, right? But you also see crooked and lies and women and hate and dangerous and politician and Bengali and et cetera and unfit. That's the kind of language that was being used. These are words we pulled off there. I don't remember other cycles recently that would have the F word, the S word, and the B word. Con, phony, fraud, danger, greedy, crooked, perjury, negligence, deception, untrustworthy. You see the point? Actually, hate and turd was used in an ad, believe it or not, and I couldn't believe it. Something's happening there in terms of our, I don't know if it's civility, that's going too far, but something's happening with the ads in terms of how they're characterizing this linguistically. That's important. And a lot more stuff that we have all kinds of results on in no time. Thank you.
All right, our last presenter is Leslie Reynard from Washburn University, American Democracy's Sad Last Days, the tabloid election of 2016.
Hello, everybody. I'm very happy to be here and have been really enjoying everybody's presentations up to now. The information I want to present today has a number of themes and topics in it that have been touched upon by other people, and it makes me feel like I'm part of a unknowingly part of a hive mentality of people that are brooding about things for about the last year or so. I'm going to just touch on some main points because this paper has already turned into about three different papers, and what I have now are talking points. I first touched on this topic on, I think it was October 18th of last year, the night of the third debate. I was facilitating a debate watch at our university library. I am from Kansas, which is a state so red that it's actually russet. So I observed the election from inside a possibly different bubble than many other academics. And like Colleen, I'm a rhetorician. I've studied presidential rhetoric. I study intractable conflict, and I'm also a Burke scholar. So I am going to have to mention something about the scapegoat process here sooner or later. Let me see if I can. Is this the clicker? Okay. We don't have clickers in Kansas. Okay, I'm kidding. That's true. We don't. I'll just use the machine. Okay, so in the run-up to the 2016 presidential election, mainstream media tended to characterize the Donald Trump candidacy as a joke, a fluke, or a quick Clinton ticket into the White House. However, pundits among elite media also overlooked a global trend in the last year toward election blindsides, including last 2 years, Scotland's rejection of independence, from the UK by 55%. Britain's vote to leave the European Union, 51.9% to 48.1%. Voters' 50.2% rejection of the peace accord with the FARC rebels in October of 2016. And so one might look at global democracies and see that we're getting pretty polarized. This is a quote that former Congresswoman Michelle Bachmann gave on the Christian Broadcasting Network that somewhat echoed what you would read in tabloid coverage of not just the elections, but the American process generally. This was indeed a tabloid-driven election. That trope, sad last days, is one that you'll see on the covers of National Enquirer, Globe, all of the magazines that are lining the checkout counter in the supermarkets. Every so often, probably every 6 or 8 weeks, there will be a picture of a beloved celebrity facing his or her sad last days. And so that put me in mind when I saw these covers related to the election process that, oh, sad last days of American democracy. And I was being facetious when I first gave that title in October, but now maybe it was prophetic. I'm not sure. The situation facing Americans in October of 2016 when the third debate watch was taking place were that people were facing a lot of economic problems, jobs insecurity, polarized haves and have-nots as the American middle class erodes away, and that is a target demographic for tabloids. A deepening cultural divide overall in terms of core values, shared values, and then also a type of apocalyptic thinking that maybe 15, 16 years later than what we usually get with apocalyptic thinking, that believe Trump cannot be much worse than what we've been tolerating for too long now. And so given the extreme negative tone of the campaign, many of those who did go to the polls, I believe, voted against a candidate rather than for a candidate. I noticed in my classes as we were talking about the election during that process that students would go, well, I can't really talk about what I think. I can't talk about it in the fraternity house. I can't talk about it in my classes because nobody's going to approve of who I want to vote for. And so I didn't think they were talking about Hillary. That was a form of silence spiral, self-censorship, acquiescence bias, social desirability biases, a lot of biases that slipped into the polls and confounded what the pollsters had found. And I'll come up on that slide in just a minute. As we've been looking at, both sides were extremely negative and not very credible in terms of integrity and leadership qualities that we want to put on the face of the American public. Overall, the lowest positive perceptions of the two candidates in the past 50 years at least. So all of the other issues and factors that crept into the campaign along with the attack ads of the candidates made the electorate feel even more mistrust of the process. On the night of the third debate, this was the standing in CNN's poll of polls. Notice that Harambe, the martyred gorilla, had 5% of the vote in August, which doesn't say a lot about the electorate taking the election that seriously. There's been a lot of morphing, probably, as we've heard, between the infotainment and the electrotainment, the parodies, the carnival-esque, which is amusing, and it is an outlet, but it is, in my opinion, degrading the process quite a bit to the point where, is it only a joke? Do we take anything seriously about the election process anymore? Or are we able to? So two things I wanted to talk about in terms of persuasion theories are dual processing theories and theories of visual rhetoric. In dual processing theories, if you aren't a rhetorician or a strategic communicator. There, it's a set of theories. There's more than one, but the elaboration likelihood model is the most familiar to people, where human beings process information either centrally, which is with the cerebral cortex, with concentration and focus, or peripherally, working on rules of thumb and heuristics. And I'm not going to say subliminal cues or subconscious cues. I'm going to call them preterological cues, because somewhere in there, there's a mind operating. We're just not always aware of it. In central processing or elaboration, people use logic. They make decisions based on rational models, and those actions and belief systems tend to be long-lasting. In peripheral processing, which is what we use most often, because the human mind just, we're bombarded with too many informations and decisions and paths of thinking to take, we can't possibly focus on everything centrally. So most of our operations are peripheral. If you've ever gone to Walmart, finished your shopping, and then come out and go, oh, where's my car? I don't remember coming here. You've been operating peripherally. These are the strongest cues in terms of short-term attitude or behavior change. And in election, I'm not sure that we, our candidates aren't, and parties aren't just aiming for a short-term behavior change. So this brings me to the topic of that I've really been thinking about a lot lately is visual metaphors and visual enthymemes. I have a handout. I'm focusing for this next section of my talk on one particular tabloid. It's the May 2nd, 2016 issue of The Inquirer, and I'll get to that in a moment. This is kind of a really good example of how quite a few persuasive peripheral processing cues are operating. I'm passing around a photocopy of that four-page spread. And as you can see, if you've had any kind of graphic design or journalism training, that is not how you lay out a magazine page. I'm sorry. I don't have any more. I'll pass the magazine around, though. So as we started seeing on Saturday Night Live, some of the satires and parodies of politicians and candidates are so genius that I myself, when I'm first looking at somebody, I'll go, well, now is that Sarah Palin or Tina Fey? And I have to sort it out. I was remembering back when Will Ferrell played Janet Reno. And then one night Janet Reno played Janet Reno. And it was just really weird. So that was an analogy that really conflated both figures into the point of not just being a visual metaphor, but being almost a condensation symbol, which is a visual or iconic symbol that's so dense with cultural meaning that it's like those little sponge capsule toys that you might give your child that comes in like a little pill and you drop it in water and a dinosaur blows up. So condensation symbols are similar to those. This one, every time I see it, I mean, the expression on the real Donald Trump's face is more extreme than the expression on the fake Donald Trump's face, which, and if you saw that clip, he's actually, the fake Donald Trump is actually kind of choreographed his skit to make the same movements that the real Donald Trump made while he was circling Hillary Clinton. So among the verbal persuasive moves, rhetorical moves that were made that triggered peripheral processing were intense language strategies that we talked about, negative halo strategies that are tying pre-demonized individuals and groups together, and then the strategic violations of political correctness norms that allowed Trump to be positioned as a powerful surrogate who could, with impunity, leak other suppressed xenophobic, misogynistic, racist, and similar hostilities. So once you've experienced the candidates performing this way, when you see the visual representations of the candidates or images that are presented of them, a sort of analogy process takes place with these pictures, completely eliminating the text, so that you don't need to see the actual candidates, you don't need to hear their actual words. It triggers your sense memories, your visual memories, and these visual analogies or metaphors where the candidates are no longer individuals, they're stand-ins for certain behaviors, certain norms that are not acceptable, and really pitting each other against each other. And that's why the spiral of silence will have kicked in there. So when you start getting partial representations of the full visual text of a situation, you can compare it to a logical syllogism where you have a minor premise, a major premise, and a conclusion. And in an enthymeme, one or more of the elements of the syllogism are missing. What happens when you have an enthymeme is that the audience fills in the missing element. And the thing about this in terms of persuasion is that an explicit conclusion is very good to guide your receivers to the sort of a conclusion that you want. If you explicitly state the conclusion that you're aiming for with your logic, then you're going to pretty much be on the same page with what your receivers hear. But if you have an enthymeme or an implicit conclusion of any kind, then you have really no control over what message is being received and built in the cognition of your receivers. In some cases, this is good. For some candidates, this is good. For other candidates, this is bad. With this news, this article, the cover date is May 2nd, 2016, which is the date of the Indiana primary. However, this article, these magazines come out probably a week to 10 days before the date on the cover. So this was already out about at least a week before the primary. At the time of the Indiana primary, Trump had already won six in a row, and Ted Cruz was his last remaining real viable opponent. Cruz was trying to get the evangelical vote, and he was the subject of a number of attack ads. A week or two before, an Inquirer article said that he'd had affairs with at least five different women, and then also his wife was called ugly. Very upsetting to the candidate, and he reacted to that. Hillary Clinton tried not to react. These are a double bind for people who undergo attack ads. You have to either try to float above it and be attacked over and over, or you have to lower yourself to try to defend yourself. And so that's really a no-win situation. What happened here was that this particular article grew legs, as they call it in journalism. Trump was interviewed about the article on Good Morning America, CNN, various other outlets. So, oh yeah, I read that. That's terrible if that happened. And apparently, it was like a self-fulfilling little spiral of a story. It, as Ernest Borman, who came up with the concept of symbolic convergence theory or fantasy theme analysis, it chained out into the mainstream medias, and the story lasted a very long time, certainly long enough for Cruz to lose the primary and then drop out of the race. Okay, this is fine. The final things I wanted to say about this particular study I'm working on is that we're talking about credibility, and in the time of Aristotle, the primary dimensions of credibility, expertise, trustworthiness, and goodwill worked well with an audience that were people who engaged in logic, ethics, and politics together as three legs of a stool. About 20 years ago, I was talking to my students about credibility, and I said the secondary dimensions, which are extroversion, composure, and sociability, seem to be more important now. And I would pose that now that we're in the 21st century, maybe there's a tertiary dimension of credibility that we could think about, where celebrity, chutzpah, and competency assessed in terms of material success are what work well with receivers. And it may be time to start, and this probably shouldn't be said, but I'm going to say it anyway, think about the quality of the electorate more than the quality of the candidates. In these days when opiates are actually the opiate of many of the people, our voters are not going to the polls with compos mentis, probably. It might be a good idea to really work more to educate people as to what a good citizen does rather than what a good candidate does. And I think the watchdog press or the lapdog press hopefully will not have to become the service dog press. Thank you.
All right, we have time for about two, three quick questions and very brief answers.
Question for the panel. What role do you think...
Who are you addressing to? You have to pick one person. We don't have time for the whole panel.
Okay, I'll address it more specifically because of the element of humor in it. What role do you think internet memes have with respect to the discourse in whether the character assassination aspect of it or more lighthearted humor aspect of it, and not necessarily just in the election, but in politics in general? How do you think they, what role do you think they play?
Anyone else on the panel who wants to answer this question? Okay. Anyone else?
You stumped the panel. Congratulations.
Yes.
Well, thank you so much for the great panel. Very, very rich. So I had several questions, so I don't know whether we have time. So the first one was related to satire. So is it, it should be more effective because we are talking about character assassination, like the conventional character attacks, or as effective, you know, like the satire. Then at the same time, I think that the second speaker, I think about Cook Hillary, I don't know whether you said that her campaign should have been more negative. That's what I understood. That's why I also something to comment. And then finally, maybe for the last speakers, I was very interested in, we have talked about democracy. And so I don't know whether, now we are analyzing the campaign, but we have the presidency. And in the previous channel, we have heard about what's happening with the press. So do you think that the current strategy or the current presidential temperament is gonna have an effect and an impact on the citizens? So is, if he's gonna be discrediting the press, shall he win the next election with this kind of a strategy? And this is basically referred to the need, maybe to the quality of the electorate to educate, you know, like citizens.
Yeah, see, I have a bias here because I don't think the electorate and they're as stupid as we give them credit for. I think they're actually doing things for good reason. And I would defend that a reasoning voter. I think there's a lot more to be said for that than our position here. Parody was done on all kinds of levels. It was done in cartoons. It was done to make unsafe topics safe. It was done to appeal to millennials. It was done to parody in popular culture ads. And there was all kinds of parody. We haven't analyzed the data there. It seemed to be done more by the third parties and not the candidates, although I don't know that for sure. But it's interesting because you would go there to do things you couldn't talk about, but what couldn't you talk about this race on the ad? So I'm not sure they just did it, but maybe they were amusing themselves to death.
Hillary Clinton ran a very negative campaign, except on Twitter. Now let me tell you how that cost her. She didn't have a hashtag that said temperamentally unfit. That's my criticism. Let me give you an example. You perhaps remember that video where he made his remark. After that video, a woman in Canada set up a website and a hashtag not okay. And she gave an example of a time she had been sexually assaulted. And she asked for other people to go and use that hashtag and testify to times when they had been sexually harassed or sexually assaulted. You may recall in my first chart, I showed you that over the course of an entire year, the top campaign hashtag was Make America Great Again with 20 million. In the period of 72 hours, 27 million women used the not okay hashtag. What does that have to do with Hillary Clinton? Hillary Clinton should have linked to it. Hillary Clinton should have thematized that and said, not okay, not okay, in every tweet that she ran for the last 3 weeks of October. And there are a million things that cost her the election because she lost by 70,000 votes in three states. I have no doubt that if she had just followed what I told you, that would have been one way she could have found those 70,000 votes in the three states that she needed. So that was my criticism, that she used Twitter poorly. If you're going to have a message and you're going to have it in your ads and you're going to have it in your speeches and you're going to have it in your print, you might as well have it on Twitter.
All right. Anyone else? Panel? So time for one more question, and then we have a very brief break, about 5 minutes, and before our last panel.
University, and I have to say it because my feminist part of me just is calling to me now. And I have to say, we have not talked about gender here at all. We have not talked about gender. And that was the turning point in this campaign. And it's something that it's an ugly feature of our culture that gender still matters and paternalistic security still matters. And this idea of the strong man still matters and still wins votes, and people will vote against their interests if they vote on this conception of a man and a leader that we all know, and that's familiar to us. So I think that's just one thing that I had to say. Thank you guys all for the panel.
This is something we'll address after the panel, so I apologize. Do panelists have anything to say to that? Any comments?
I just made a comment about the gendered confrontation, so I don't know what you're talking about.
All right. Let's take this conversation after the panel. So thank you so much for this wonderful panel, and have a break for 5 minutes.